Father, for being with us, for sending your great Comforter, the Holy Spirit. Give us wisdom, insight into your word, discernment of every letter of your word, that we may gain in our understanding and come closer to you in the process, Father, as you increase our faith. In the name of the Son, Yeshua. Hallelujah. Welcome to the third part of chapter 2, and finally we're going to wrap this chapter 2, and not all of the story of Eden. We're going to move into chapter 3, and there's more about it there, but at least we'll get this over with and hopefully move into a little bit of chapter 3 today. I want to kick this off with a word from Paul, Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Obviously, as we dive into the word and we believe, we must first believe. Our faith is increased. But this, Paul is addressing this to the Jewish people. If we look at how this chapter begins, brethren, this is verse 1, brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. In other words, he's witness that they have a zeal for God, but it is not based in their knowledge of God. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. So Christ was the fulfillment of the law and the end of this ridiculousness of the Pharisees, which continues today. As I mentioned, and I think it was maybe the previous or the video before, only 30,000 Messianic Jews in Israel out of a population of about 8 million Jews. Now, whether all of those are real Jewish people, there's a lot of fake Jews. There's a lot, they were actually gypsies, they were Romanian, they were Eastern European that learned this variation of Hebrew, the Yiddish type Hebrew, and they are not God's people. But yet they live in Israel as Jews. So that's a whole separate story. I don't want to get lost in that. But the Pharisees, the law of the Pharisees, if we really understand the New Testament, everything that Yeshua attacked in the New Testament was Pharisee law and demonic activity. When he healed someone of, when he healed the blind, it was deliverance from a demon that had made that individual blind. When he made a man walk, it was deliverance of the demon that had crippled that man. When he turned the water into wine, it was actually a mockery of a ridiculous Pharisee. I don't know if it was Pharisee law or priest procedure that the way that they purified their water in this well and blessed it and made it holy and whatnot for their purposes. It was absolutely ridiculous, and that was the water that Yeshua turned to wine, making a joke out of him at the wedding that he attended, and he said he'd bring the wine. Anyway, we'll get into all that story. I hope we eventually have time to get around to some of these really incredible stories after we move on from a little bit more of this in Genesis. Get on with our foundation, understanding the origin of things. I want to suggest that in Genesis, if you're really interested in this and have the time, please go to YouTube and find Chuck Missler's videos on the book of Genesis. He does a dissertation on the entire book of Genesis that is absolutely just fabulous. But you have to have the time. If you think what I'm doing takes a long time, he'll spend 3 sessions on one verse. So be prepared, but it is so, so deep. And we actually disagree on some things. And the reason, one of them is Genesis 1:1 in the beginning. One of the reasons, and he may be right, I don't know. I'm not saying that he's wrong. I don't want to say that. I don't want to suggest that. But what I do want to suggest is that when I made the decision to go with the recreation of the earth and not the creation of all things in Genesis 1 was it was a difficult decision, and I made that decision because I was following the Hebrew, the Semitic languages PhD, Dr. Merrill Unger. I decided that his interpretation was probably the most accurate. Now, I'm quite certain that Chuck Missler has read those interpretations of Dr. Unger, because I've heard him mention Dr. Unger before in some of his tapes and videos. But you know, we have to follow what we think we're being guided by the Holy Spirit. You have to always begin everything with prayer and ask the Holy Spirit to come in and guide you. Don't ever open the Bible without the guidance of the Holy Spirit, or it's a waste of time. You'll just be confused and close the Bible and walk away. Always begin everything with a prayer and ask to be blessed, that the Holy Spirit would open your eyes to interpretation and understanding. And this is something that poor Israel, they really struggle. They have struggled for so long, and they still struggle today. And what they're about to go through is the refiner's fire. Only one third of Israel is going to come out of this alive. I should say saved. I doubt any of them come out of it alive. But one third are going to get out of this, and two thirds of them are going to have to die a very, very, very brutal, horrible death in the tribulation, which hopefully none of us are here to witness. Hopefully we're enjoying the bride's supper in another location. I wanted to kick this off with that. I think Paul is by far, his interpretations of the gospel are just incredible. I want to get around eventually. I have done quite a bit of study on the subject of faith, and I want to eventually get around to that. I may do it fairly soon. We'll see. But I think we need. I want to point out something. This faith by works and this deception that comes from Catholicism is very important to understand. And it's actually the reason that we're confused about faith comes from the way that Roman Catholics understand faith and the extreme influence that Roman Catholicism has had on Protestantism and Christianity. And we need to get over that. We need to understand faith. Martin Luther had difficulty reconciling the difference between James and Paul's faith of works and faith as a gift. Paul says faith is a gift. And actually, they are one and the same, and it's a difference in the way that we understand the two, that they actually coincide with each other. I want to get into all of that. For now, let's wrap up Genesis chapter 2, and we're going to learn a lot here about Lucifer, ourselves, and get into eventually when we get to chapter 6. The origins of demons. All right, Father, thank you for being with us in this. Hallelujah. You know what? Let's let this song from Tasha Layton wash over us here for a minute, and then we'll continue on with the rest of Genesis chapter 2.
Can you make something from the wreckage? Would you take this heart and make it whole again? Though the mountains may if I'm honest, maybe I've blamed you too. But you would not forsake me, 'cause only good things come from you. Though the mountains may be moved into the sea,
That's a tough act to follow. She has a beautiful voice. Okay, so I think let's wrap up chapter 2, get on with it, cover a few more things that we see about Adam, and move on to chapter 3. So Genesis 2, 15 through 25, and the Lord God took the man, put him in the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou may freely eat, but of the tree of knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it, for in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. The Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make an help meet for him. In other words, make a helper suitable for him. And out of the ground the Lord formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. This is the reason I say Adam was the administrator of the earth. He's being given all of creation to name it. God placed creation on the earth, handed it to Adam to see what he would name it. And he's given the responsibility of the garden as well. This is animals of all of the earth, all of Eden, and responsible for the sanctuary of Yahuwah Elohim on earth, which was the garden. So he's of a stature. This is not comparable to the man of day 6 anyway. And Adam gave names to all cattle and to the fowl of the air and to every beast of the field, but for Adam there was not found a help meet for him. No suitable help for Adam. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. Something interesting to point out real quick is the rib is the only part of the body, of the human body, that has the ability to regenerate itself. And so it's interesting that that God chose Adam's rib, the only portion of the body, bone there, or part of the body that can actually regenerate itself, is what was taken. And makes sense that he would take the rib, but I think most people don't really realize that. The idea is that she was made from one of his ribs because she came from his side and would be at his side. That's always been the theology of that, but which is, I'm sure, very true. But it's also very true that the rib is the only part of the body that can regenerate itself. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he woman and brought her unto the man. Now this, see again, this doesn't match Genesis 1, 126, 27, where he created them, created he them, male and female, commanded them to populate, replenish the earth. I mean, that doesn't match this narrative here. That just doesn't match the narrative that Adam was created and was alone, no help suitable for him, and so put him into a deep sleep and created the woman. It just does not match the chapter 1 narrative. So in my mind, I don't care what you do to get there. Adam was not the first man. Anyway, I've beat that horse to death. Adam said, this is now bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Taken out of him. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. And they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. There's really not much else. Let's move on to chapter 3 because there's really not much else to go over here. We see that obviously there was one law given to Adam. It was only one command, which was do not eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. That was it. That's the only law he had to follow that we know of. I'm going to say that I believe that they were also commanded to take the Sabbath. They were commanded to take the day of rest. But the Bible doesn't say that. It was not a law at that time, but I'm going to say that it had to have been. I think even though that is not mentioned here, that had to have been the case. The reason it's reiterated in Exodus with the Ten Commandments is because the Israelites are coming out of captivity, 400 years of Egyptian slavery, where they learned Egyptian pagan worship. So I think it's the law is reiterated there, but it's never engraved in stone, literally, until the book of Exodus, but I'm going to say that that law was probably the case here. Anyway, as far as we know, he's only got one rule to follow, and that is don't touch the tree or you will surely die, which means the other tree will be removed. The tree of life would be removed from him. Let's call it good. Let's get on with chapter 3 because that's where we begin to explain. It's the beginning. It's the declaration of war. And there's a lot more here that goes on in chapter 3, so let's get with it. Finally, Genesis chapter 3. So we have a very peaceful situation up until now, except for the chaos that the state of chaos that the earth was in, which is basically, by the way, that's kind of the law of entropy. There's as Chuck Missler explains, there's a tremendous amount of energy is required to prevent chaos. In other words, atoms, molecules, everything in creation is organized. It takes a lot of energy to keep it organized. Its natural state is to go back to chaos. In the absence of God, things return to chaos, which is called the law of entropy, I believe. Anyway, so in chapter 3, we have everything very beautiful in chapter 1 and chapter 2, and in chapter 3, now we have a different situation. So Genesis chapter 3, verse 1 through 7. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest ye die. The serpent said unto the woman, Surely ye shall surely not die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, there it is, make one wise. She took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. So we went very quickly from the earth that was in chaos, that the chaos was reorganized and recreated. Everything was paradisal. There was no problems. There was no issues. Everything was perfect. God saw everything was good. All of a sudden, we get to chapter 3, and here's this serpent in the enclosure, the secure enclosure of God, the Garden of Eden, and he's trying to undermine God's work there. So this is our first indication that whatever happened, the war in heaven between Lucifer and a third of his followers. We don't know what angelic ranks they were from. I would assume that there were a few of all of the ranks. We're going to take a look at what the Bible says about Lucifer and how we know his authority, his power in heaven before this fall. But the serpent is our main character here of Genesis chapter 3. And there's something definitely wrong in this picture. This is not a peaceful situation. He's there undermining. He's conniving. He's deceiving this new creation. I believe there's a tremendous amount of jealousy involved in this situation. Adam being given planet Earth, being given Eden, that obviously must be very important throughout the heavens. It must be a very important destination throughout the universe. And whatever happened that caused the fall, they were thrown down here because this is the location of their whatever it was that they did that provoked God's anger and caused this war. They were cast down here because this was a source of the original sin. Whatever happened before all of this that we don't know. We don't know the whole story. It's not given. But anyway, this serpent, let's take a look a little bit more about this serpent, because he's our main character here. So this serpent, all right, I'm going back to the book of Enoch. Nobody likes to hear that, but it's really one of the few resources that gives us any clarity into what happened in the beginning of Genesis. Even then, it's vague, and you still have to put pieces of the puzzle together. But Enoch describes, by the way, when you go to the books of Enoch, it's Enoch 1 is the only one that's of any use. The other two are just disinformation campaigns of the Pharisees, I believe. But it's Enoch, what is it, chapter 17, verse 1. Then I was taken to a place where the angels appeared as a burning fire. And by the way, he refers to these, I'm going to put it on a slide here so we can see it. He refers to these as fiery serpents, burning serpents. And it's interesting that there's several occasions of fiery serpents in the Bible. We're going to take a look at them. All right. So then I was taken to a place where the angels appeared as a burning fire, yet if they desired, could make themselves look as men. This is what happened here. Eve was beguiled by a fiery serpent. So, I tell you what, let's finish reading the rest of this chapter, and then break this down bit by bit. Let's start with verse 8 and read the rest of the chapter. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. The Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree which I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? The man said, The woman thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. Oh, of course, he's immediately shifting blame. The Lord God said unto the woman, What is this that thou hast done? And the woman said, The serpent beguiled me. We're going to take a close look at that word. And I did eat. And the Lord God said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, above every beast of the field. Upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. That's peculiar, since we know seed to be genetic, passed down from generation to generation. So that's we need to look at that. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband, and he shall rule over thee. And unto Adam he said, Because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of the wife, the woman, I believe it says in the original King James, and hast eaten of the tree of which I commanded thee, saying, Thou shalt not eat of it, cursed is the ground for thy sake, in sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face shalt thou eat bread, till thou return unto the ground, for out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. And Adam called his wife's name Eve, because, remember Hava in the last chapter, because she was the mother of all the living. And unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord God make coats of skins and clothe them. We need to take a closer look at that. That was the original covering of sin. And the Lord God said, Behold, the man is become as one of us, to know good and evil. So evil existed before the man. And now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life and eat and live forever. Therefore the Lord God sent him forth forth from the Garden of Eden to till the ground from whence he was taken. This is interesting. So he was taken from some ground outside of Eden. So he drove out the man, and he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden cherubims and a flaming sword which turned every way to keep the way of the tree alive. All right. Let's go back now to the serpent. I want to start breaking this down. It's going to take a little while, and I don't know how far we'll get today, but we'll get as far as we can. So getting back to the serpent, going to Strong's Concordance, of course, just in the direct verse translation, now the serpent, in the beginning of that verse, it's translates as a serpent. And you go to the Strong's Hebrew 5175, and everything you'll find there is references to the serpent. Nahash, Nahash, or something like that is, I don't know exactly how it's pronounced. And so that's a little frustrating because we know that there's more to it than this. And anyway, so if you just keep digging, what you find is if you reverse it, okay, so in what I believe is a seraphim, of an angelic hierarchy, the seraphim were next to the throne of God. They surrounded the throne of God, and I think who knows how many of them there were. I would say they probably varied in rank among them. They weren't all of the same rank. But these were, Lucifer was originally a seraph. And so getting into the seraph, if we do it backwards, look at the seraph in Strong's Concordance, and what do you know? Look what we find here. The serpent. Seraph, fiery serpent. Burning. So this matches exactly Enoch's description of what they were. Enoch was the first one to describe these as serpents, burning serpents that had the ability to change themselves into men. This is what was in the garden. Okay, why was it there? What is going on that this thing is there? And I think we have to look at this in terms of war. So something happened. This to cause this fall in heaven. Something happened. These guys are not, whoever these seraphim are, they're not happy about it, or at least some of them are. And I'm assuming that not all of them. It could have been they were part of the third that were cast down. I don't think all third were of the same order of angels. I think there was various hierarchies of angels that were cast down with Lucifer. But this is definitely, we have to look at this in terms of war. This seraph that's in the enclosure, I'm going to say was probably, and we're going to look at some other evidence of this here. He was who Adam usurped for this power. And he's trying to get it back, of course. Well, actually, he does. I mean, this all ends up going back to Lucifer. So he derails Adam, usurps Adam, derails God's plan, and everything reverts back to Lucifer. These are acts of war. There's something going on here that our problem and Adam's problem that became our problem is an extension of this war. It's not the war itself. It's an extension of this war. But let's look at something here. We get into, let's take a look at another verse real quick. Genesis 3:15, and I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, thou shalt bruise his heel. This is the first prophecy of the Messiah, the seed of the woman. Good guess as to who the seed of the serpent is. I can tell you who occult societies believe it is. They believe they're of the line of Cain. We'll get to that here in a minute, or in the next chapter. Not in a minute. We're not going to finish this today, but get to it in the next chapter. But this was God's declaration of war. This is the first prophecy of the Messiah. this was how order would be restored. And I don't think that the seraph saw this coming. When he usurped Adam, I don't think he saw that God himself would come through as a man and rescue. We were so important to God. Whatever this plan was that he had, whether it be the verse that I read from Isaiah 51, whatever God's plan for humanity was extremely important. And in the Messiah coming through as a man, we were elevated to a rank above the angels. So that's how we get all of this authority. When we get to chapter 6 and we see who the demons are, you'll see why they have absolutely no authority whatsoever. They have no authority. They are illegal. They were never, their existence was never intended. Their existence is illegal. And we'll get to all of that. I don't want to get too distracted right now. Let's finish here with, let's get to some more of these details from Genesis 3, where God says unto the woman, "What is this thou hast done?" The woman said, "The serpent beguiled me." Let's go into Strong's and look at that word beguiled, because it gives us another clue as to what's going on here. Strong's Concordance for Beguile, 5377, Nasha. Beguile, deceive greatly, utterly. A primitive root, to lead astray mentally, to delude, or morally, to seduce. Beguile, deceive greatly, utterly. So this subtle creature is greatly beguiling Eve. And this word, it's interesting that almost every occurrence of this word in the Bible is definitely deceptive. However, the translation, I mean, right here in front of us, it says morally, to seduce. Eve was seduced by this serpent. The serpent's goal was to bring total condemnation on Adam and Eve. And he used Eve to do it, because obviously, not to say that Eve, I mean, Eve was from Adam. She was of the same genetics. But we're talking about a man who was given an intelligence level to that of angels. This is a man comparable to angels who was given responsibility. He was usurping these angels with his authority over the planet. He was Lord of Eden. And obviously, I think if you were going to try to play chess with him, let's just, you know, to try to describe the kind of intelligence that I believe Adam had, I don't think anyone could ever. I think he was the most intelligent man ever created, because he's the first. He's directly from God. He's had no flaw. He's totally flawless. This is an extremely intelligent being. And so because angelic are almost always appear as male, when they come into the form of humans, they're always male. It also makes sense that the female would be the one to be seduced. But I also believe that the goal was to collapse, bring condemnation down on Eve first, and then let Eve bring it down on Adam, which she successfully did. This was a seduction. This is a reason that it appears to be sexual in nature, where they have covered their genitals in fig leaves. They're hiding the source of their shame. And the fig, by the way, I don't want to neglect that. I want to try to get to it before the end of this video. But this becomes iconic, an iconic representation of sin and disobedience throughout the Bible. Israel is represented as the fig tree. The fig tree becomes symbolic of sin. And in fact, I want to tie something together here. It's probably not the right time right now, but hopefully before we get done with this, I want to tie something in that I have been searching desperately for since I went on this venture, this journey, is that I believe that the crucifixion, if you go into the Greek, this word for cross was parabellum, which is actually a beam. He was nailed to a beam, and the beam was hung in the fig tree that he cursed in front of Nathaniel. we'll get into more of that. You know, that's something that it's what I believe happened. It's hard to prove, but a lot of this stuff's hard to prove. I mean, a lot of this stuff, you have to just put all these little pieces together and draw a picture is what we have to do, because there's, first of all, this is all very old. I mean, we're talking thousands and thousands of years. We don't know what all is missing. I believe the Book of Enoch. In fact, let's take a look at a couple of references before people think that I'm wacko going to Enoch. Let's look at a couple of references in the Bible of the Book of Enoch. Let's start with Genesis 5, verses 18 through 24. When Jared had lived 162 years, he became the father of Enoch. After he became the father of Enoch, Jared lived 800 years and had other sons and daughters, 20 altogether. Jared lived a total of 962 years, and then he died. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. After he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked faithfully with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Altogether, Enoch lived a total of 365 years. Enoch walked faithfully with God, then he was no more because God took him away. Well, what happened to him? We find that in Hebrews 11, 5, and 6 from Paul. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So Enoch was taken. And there's more about Enoch in other places, but I'm just going to use the Bible for now. There's some explanations in Enoch as to how he was, I mean, I'm sorry, in Jubilees as to how he was taken. But he was one of only two people that left this earth without having to experience death. One was Elijah, the other was Enoch. So, wouldn't we want to know more about this guy who walked with God for 300 years? Who had a relationship with God for three centuries? Don't you think he had a few things to write down and say about how the world was back then and his perspective on things, having that perfect relationship with God, so perfect that he was taken without having to experience death? In fact, the only individual from pre-flood times to be taken without the experience of death was Enoch. The only person after pre-flood times was Elijah. That's it. There's only those two. No one else has pleased God to the extreme that he takes them away without the experience of death. All right, let's look a little bit more about Enoch. By the way, and it is impossible, and without faith it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. What is one of the rewards? It's faith. Keep that in mind. And last but not least, in the book of Jude, chapter 1, is always comical because there's only one chapter in Jude, but Jude chapter 1, verses 14 through 16, Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all of them of all the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness and of all the defiant words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These people are grumblers and fault finders that follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves and flatter others for their own advantage. Okay. So what Bible are they reading from that they have these prophecies from Enoch? Well, obviously Enoch was in the Bible at one time. This has been proven in the caves of Qumran, which, by the way, don't ever believe the lie that those were the Essene priests in that cave. That was John the Baptist in the wilderness, where he was one of the official priestly scribes that kept up with all of the biblical scrolls and the priestly scrolls. Anyway, so the Book of Enoch in the Dead Sea Scrolls, that was proven to be part of the Bible. It's very interesting that I don't know how many, there was a total of around 360 books, the books of Enoch, we should say. So he wrote a tremendous volume of information that we're down to just a little minuscule portion of today. When these were discovered, the archaeologists that discovered them, of course, we don't know the whole story. At least somebody knows the whole story. I don't know the whole story. But when these archaeologists discovered these scrolls, of course, you can imagine the people that were there immediately. And one of those was the Vatican. And the Vatican bought up very quickly the books of Enoch. We ended up with a portion of it that has been deciphered enough to verify what we already knew about the first book of Enoch, that was the Ethiopian version that was already in publication. And I think the Aramaic had been lost in that book, but the Greek, I believe the Greek was maintained, and I don't know what other language, possibly Hebrew. And it's interesting that once the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, they're able to cross-reference a lot of the information and correct some of the translations from the Greek that had come from probably from Aramaic. These were retained in Ethiopia, which spawned another conspiracy theory that's an absolute lie, that Solomon had a child with Sheba, who was from Africa, and they had, you know, it's just absolutely ridiculous. Queen of Sheba was from the Philippines. So let's get on with Enoch. I wanna cover something else here real quick, and let's verify what I just want to make sure everybody understands. Enoch was a biblical prophet. He was the first prophet. The first one to prophesy the Son of Man was Enoch. He knew these things. We have to use this information to get to the truth. We can't ignore it. And another thing I'll tell you that Christians have been guilty of, I don't know for how long, but at least from probably the time of the Latin translations, have been trying to sanitize a lot of these biblical accounts to make them less ugly. You know, fallen angels cohabitating with human women. Whatever happened here in the Garden of Eden was obviously of a sexual nature. We don't have all the details. It was obviously of a sexual nature. And what apple, by the way? They covered themselves in fig leaves. So where'd the apple come from? There's so many things we got to purge our brains of and expand our minds and begin to wrap our minds around the truth of what happened. Because if we don't do that, if we fail to do this correctly, which most churches have, we're engaged in a spiritual warfare that we know nothing about the enemy. We have to know our enemy. And we're not going to know our enemy if we keep sanitizing the truth of these biblical accounts. So let's stop trying to make them prettier. Let's just leave them as ugly as they need to be. Again, this is our story. This is the Bible is written for us. It details everything that's wrong with human character throughout the Bible. If this was about God, it would be a much prettier story. It's about man and God coming back together is the purpose of the Bible. These are the points we need to make sure and get across, especially to our children, that they don't fall into deceptions. I mean, it took me over 50 years of my life to begin to work my way out of things that I was raised to believe as a child. And most of them were not, it's not that they were bad. They're just not accurate. How are you going to combat a spiritual enemy that you know nothing about? Something that you can't see. This is how we see that enemy. We get to the truth of what happened. So let's don't ignore Enoch. We have to include him in this. He's very important, very crucial, very vital in understanding exactly what happened in these biblical accounts, especially in the book of Genesis. All right, let's keep going. So let's review Enoch. Then I was Enoch 17:1 in the book of Enoch. Enoch 1, stay away from the rest of the books of Enoch. There's only one that's legitimate. Then I was taken to a place where the angel appeared as a burning fire, yet if they desired could make themselves look as men. Enoch 20 verse 7, Gabriel, one of the holy angels, Gabriel is an archangel, who is over paradise, that would have been the Garden of Eden at the time, the garden, the enclosure, and the serpents, see this word crosses, this word seraphim and serpent crosses back and forth, and the cherubim. So this entity that was in the enclosure that seduced Eve, caused her to commit this horrible act that she in turn shared with her husband once she learned about the effects of this fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Once this occurred, this is a new level in this war between these entities and God. And I do not believe, I believe this was, let's think of this entity as probably who would have been the king over the earth when the earth was within Lucifer's, whatever his corner of the universe was that he was in charge of. And we're going to take a look at how we know that he had a greater authority than just the planet of, just this planet Earth. This seraphim serpent, this burning angel that could change himself to look as a man, this was probably the king over the earth. And he wanted his power back. He's going to get it. He's like, you know what, these guys, I'm not bowing down to a bunch of, I mean, imagine mankind being elevated to the rank of angel. God was intending to make Adam Lord of the earth. He's conditioning, he's training him to become Lord of the earth. And these angels are furious. These people that this authority had been taken away from, they're furious about this. They're going to get it back. This is war. But these are actually provoking God. If we go to Genesis 3:15, they have provoked God to war. Now, whatever happened before this, the war escalated in Genesis 3:15. All right. So we cannot ignore Enoch. We have to pay attention to this book of Enoch in order to get a better picture of what this entity was. It was in the garden seducing Eve, causing her to commit this act. This is what I think happened. And I'm going to go into a little bit of conjecture, just drawing a picture. All right, bear with me. I'm going to read to you from an article published from the University of Kansas, I believe in 2013. Most dinosaur bones discovered are highly radioactive. Because of this, the bones displayed in museums are covered with heavily leaded paint. Elemental uranium does not occur in nature. This isotope forms through combination with oxygen and several uranium oxidized minerals and compounds, which of course that's basic. There's a lot more to it than that. To explain the pervading evidence of radioactivity during ancient times, scientists at NASA and the University of Kansas claim that gamma ray bursts could have facilitated mass extinctions that would have remodeled our atmosphere. A gamma ray burst consists of a sudden explosion of a nearby star that may well have depleted half of the Earth's atmospheric protective ozone layer. A gamma ray burst originating within 6,000 light years from Earth would have a devastating effect on life, said Dr. Adrian Melotte of the Department of Physics and Astronomy at the University of Kansas. We don't know exactly when one came, but we're rather sure it did come and left its mark. What's most surprising is that just a 10-second burst can cause years of devastating ozone damage. I'm going to tell you something. Putting all the pieces together, I believe that these were another corrupted manipulation of creation of these same seraphim fallen angels that one of these of which was in the Garden of Eden and seduced Eve into bringing condemnation from God upon her and Adam. And this was the beginning, probably, of this war in heaven. I don't know this. I'm merely putting pieces of evidence together, drawing. What happens is you begin to look at all of this evidence, history of the earth, history of the dinosaurs, and then you hear this. The dinosaurs were nuked. I mean, this is obvious. They were nuked. Because we have life on Earth today, there are certain centipedes, millipedes, crocodiles, alligators. There is life on Earth that was from before prehistoric times. It survived. Well, nothing would have survived a gamma ray burst of, you know, uranium. They were bombed, you know, with these nuclear bombs. This is what happened. So I think that the chaos, again, please, you know, do your own research. I don't want to confuse anybody, but just as much as I've read and put these pieces together, it begins to draw a picture of this war began as a result of the extinction of these Jurassic creatures, that some of which were natural, but because we know that they were so many of them were so violent, and they had very unique abilities, ways of communicating with each other by controlling sound and that sort of thing. These are very unique animals. They had intelligence. I think they were a corrupted creation of these same seraphim that just one of the big bosses of which has just seduced Eve in this narrative here from Genesis chapter 3. That's what I think. I could be totally way off base. My drinking days warped my brain. I don't know, but this is just what I believe. I think it makes a lot of sense. Anyway, I don't want to get too far out on this, but I'm telling you, when we start to learn that these, we're talking a serpent, we're talking a reptile that is also a burning angel, that has the ability to transform himself into a man. This is, this is wild stuff. You can't make this up. This is wild stuff. And I'm going to show you something else, that these winged serpents were considered gods. And the pyramids, by the way, the Egyptian pyramids, I really want to get into all of that. The Egyptian pyramids were built, I don't want to give away too many details of what we're going to get into here later, but these were built in pre-flood times with technology of these incredibly intelligent beings, and they utilized something else that they created, which we'll get into. Inside these pyramids, you see all kinds of manipulated, corrupted creation, which was the reason that the earth was wiped out by a flood. The depictions in these pyramids draw the pictures of the reason that the genetics had become so corrupted on planet Earth. God had, he lost his patience and said, that's it, we're going to put this to an end. I think it was the second time that this happened. The first time was the dinosaurs. I believe they were wiped out in an angry, violent rage because, God did not want any possibility. Their DNA had to be totally, totally annihilated. No possibility of them ever coming back. They were nuked. Very interesting. Anyway, I thought you'd find this interesting from the University of Kansas. I want to get on with the rest of this. I don't want to get too sidetracked, but I believe this is what happened. I believe this entity in the garden was one of the very same entities responsible for this this corrupted creation that was nuked and was probably the reason for this war in heaven, but we don't know that. I'm extrapolating. I'm making things up here as I go, but it's just based on a lot of evidence and a lot of reading. I think we need to get close to wrapping this up and start a new session where in the next session I want to get a little more information about Lucifer, his origins, who he was, what he looks like. He's not the ugly beast that pictures are drawn of. He was, according to the Most High God himself, he was one of the most beautiful of all of creation. We want to know a little more about him, because little by little, we're going to get to what is spiritual warfare today, where it comes from. This is the beginning of it. This is where it begins, right here. So let's review, going back to chapter 2. Adam was put in the enclosure, the sanctuary of the Most High God on earth, the Garden of Eden, to dress it and keep it. He was given a woman who was made from his rib, the only portion of the human body that has the ability to regenerate itself. If we get on to chapter 3, they were, the end of chapter 2, they were naked and they had no idea that they were naked. Chapter 3 comes along, all of a sudden, this peaceful environment is a different picture evolves. We have this serpent, who I believe is a seraph of the angelic order of seraphs, and a portion of which fell with Lucifer. We don't know how many. We know that seraphs, one of the things I meant to cover and get around to and I didn't, was Isaiah chapter 6. I should probably post that here before we get too far, so we have a better picture of these seraphs. Let me put this on the video and then we'll continue with this wrap up. Isaiah chapter 6, I'm gonna go ahead and stick this in here even though I'm trying to wrap this up, because we need to finish drawing a picture of who this serpent was. Now, in Isaiah chapter 6, he's discussing the good seraphim. These are obviously the ones that have not fallen because they're covering the throne of God. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 1, In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. This is his worshipers. Obviously, he's the temple is filled with entities worshiping God. And this is in a dream that Isaiah had. Above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With twain he covered his face, and with twain he covered his feet, and with twain he did fly. In other words, with two wings he covered his face, two wings he covered his feet, and the other two he flew with. So he's a six-winged creature. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. This holy, 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 by the way, there's a couple places we'll see this in the Bible. It's holy is the Father, holy is the Son, holy is the Holy Spirit. It's always holy, holy, holy for the triune God. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. Then said I, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for mine eyes have seen the King of the Lord of hosts. He's scared. Then flew one of the seraphim unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. I believe this live coal is a type of stone that emits light, and obviously it's a purifying fire of sorts. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, Lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin purged. We get a totally different picture of the seraphim than the one that I've been drawing, because I've been talking about the bad ones, and these are the good ones. There are some that fell with Lucifer. These obviously did not fall. These are the ones that still remain at the altar of God, at the throne of God. So that's important to know. I don't want to neglect the fact that we have to understand Genesis 3:15 is probably the biggest thing that comes out of this whole chapter, even though I want to continue on with other things. We have to understand God declared war with Genesis 3:15. This was the serpent's doing. We see where the serpent is the first one cursed. When God is called to Adam's attention, the Lord said unto the woman, What is it thou hast done? The serpent seduced me. We'll use that word. We can use deceived or beguiled as well. I did eat. The Lord said unto the serpent, Because thou hast done this, thou art cursed above all cattle, above every beast of the field, and upon thy belly shalt thou go, and dust shalt thou eat all the days. What was dust? Dust was the man. The man came from dust. The man would return to dust. So this the seraphim, the serpent, has been condemned. He has been changed into a less powerful being, almost probably, I would say, almost on the level of maybe demonic, and is doomed to pursue man for his entire life. Man was dust. Then Genesis 3:15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. There's this confusing remark about the seed of the serpent. We got to get into more of this, but I have not been able to reconcile this. We'll see when we get into chapter 4. I have dug and dug and dug, and I cannot reconcile this. There are a lot of scriptures that lead us to believe that Eve was impregnated by this entity, but the Bible doesn't really agree with that. I can't get the book of Jubilees to agree with it. I can't find anything that agrees with it except conspiracy theorists and the occult, who believe that they are from the line of Cain, and Cain was seed of Lucifer. That's what they believe. And whether it's true or not, I don't know, but I'm telling you, that's what they believe. I cannot reconcile it. I don't want to get lost in that right now. We'll look at it in chapter 4. So, you know, Adam hearkening unto the voice of the woman rather than hearkening unto God. He was easily misled. We see God making the coats of skins, which was their first covering. I want to address that in the next session. And also very important to address in the next session is the covering of the fig leaves and how the fig becomes symbolic and iconic of sin and of Israel, the fig tree. And I firmly believe it was that the crucifixion took place upon a fig tree. He was nailed to a beam, and the beam was hung from a fig tree. I can't prove that. But it ties together everything from the first sin, the covering of the fig leaves, trying to hide their sin, to the fact that he was crucified on a fig tree to put an end to it. The fruitless law, he fulfilled it. That was the end of it. I think, you know, I can't prove that. I know it in my heart to be true. I hope that before I leave this earth, I can find some evidence of it. But if not, you know, if it's not true, then we'll just stick with the Roman cross. It's just the Roman cross just doesn't fit the whole Bible story of the fig being the source of the original sin and the fig tree that he cursed before Nathaniel. Well, something else had to have happened to that tree. We'll get into it more later down the road. Maybe somebody listening to this video has some information that can help us put these pieces together. I think we're gonna close it here today. I know that I've skipped over some things that I want to get. We'll just have to get to them in the next session because I'm already over an hour. And thank you, Father, for being with us in this. Keep our eyes open. Keep our minds sharp. Please, please give us wisdom in this. We don't want to make mistakes. We want to interpret accurate interpretations of your word, accurate understandings of your word. We're trying to get closer to you, not farther from you, by making mistakes and misinterpretations. Please, Father, bring us closer to you. In the name of your Son, Yeshua. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Thank you.